Hezekiah is a great king. Great king. When great hordes were coming against him, he leaned heavily upon the Lord, and the Lord gave him a huge, magnificent victory. And this was kind of the capstone of the spiritual revival that God was bringing about through the righteous reforms of Hezekiah, great king. But then he got sick. And when he got sick, he cried out to the Lord regarding his illness. He's basically saying, there's still so much more work to be done, Lord. Could my life just be spared for a little bit longer so that some more of this work could be accomplished? And God, in answer to that prayer, gave him 15 more years. God was gracious to Hezekiah. But then, envoys came from Babylon. And when the envoys came from Babylon, Hezekiah did a very, very puzzling thing. He showed them everything. Everything. All of the riches and the armory, everything. Why? Why? When a prophet comes to him, when Isaiah came to him and said to him, what have you shown to the envoys of Babylon? I've shown them everything. Isaiah has to say that the day is coming when the Babylonians will attack Israel and take them captive after Hezekiah's days. What was so wrong about Hezekiah showing all of these things to Babylon? No doubt he was seeking to make a political alliance with a possible enemy, Babylon. Hezekiah was committing the same sin of those who leaned upon Egypt for strength instead of leaning on God. When the hallmark of Hezekiah's life has been to lean on the Lord, he makes a huge mistake here. Almost better if he had not prayed that his life would have been extended. Here's the result. Isaiah 39, verse 5. Isaiah 39, verse 5. This reading is coming up, by the way. And if I don't do this now, I'm going to miss the very important transition between chapters 39 and then 40 and following. Remember, 39 passages of prophetic judgment and hope. And then 27 chapters of fulfillment. Okay. So we're at the tail end of it, the transition, the hinge. Verse 5, then Isaiah said to Hezekiah, hear the word of the Lord of hosts. Behold, the days are coming when all that is in your house and that which your fathers have stored up till this day shall be carried to Babylon. Nothing shall be left, says the Lord. And some of your own sons who will come from you, whom you will father, shall be taken away, and they shall be eunuchs in the palace of the king of Babylon. Look at the irresponsible way that Hezekiah responds. Then Hezekiah said to Isaiah, the word of the Lord that you have spoken is good. For he thought, there will be peace and security in my days. What? At least people will speak well of my reign. Really? I really don't understand it. How could such a good king be so irresponsible? But then, the Bible has a way of showing up the faults of those who look perfect. All the kings have flaws, to point us to the fact that they are not the true king. They point to the true Messiah that Isaiah has been prophesying about. Remember yesterday? The king who will reign in righteousness? Here he comes. Chapter 40, verse 1, comfort, comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that her warfare is ended, that her iniquity is pardoned, and that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. Verse 3, a voice cries, in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Let me show you the beautiful way that Jesus fulfills all these words. Whose voice is this crying out in the wilderness? Prepare the way. Well, that voice, unequivocally, according to the Gospels, is the voice of John the Baptist, who comes in the spirit of Elijah and is this voice that prepares the way for the Messiah. The next couple of lines are very, very intriguing, and they can apply, at least partially, to John the Baptist, or they can all be about Jesus. Please don't be confused. But look where it says, in the wilderness. What is that? Immediately, you might go to the thought that, okay, John the Baptist was in the wilderness, and people came out to the wilderness to be baptized by John the Baptist, who is a wild man. It's possible, and that's usually the reading of the New Testament passages that speak of John the Baptist's ministry. But notice, at least in my Bible, the grammar doesn't flow that way. This is the part of the message. In the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. And if that's the right reading, it is speaking of in the wilderness, prepare the way. Namely, it points to Jesus' temptations in the wilderness. Remember? Matthew chapter 4, Luke chapter 4, these are the passages to go to. But the Gospels clearly tell us that Jesus, before he embarked on his public ministry, before he was revealed to the people of Israel, he prepared himself. The way was prepared. In the wilderness, as he fasted for 40 days and took the devil head on and destroyed him, or at least debilitated him, until he would crush his head at the cross. It was then, when he had bound the strong man, that Jesus' public ministry began, after the preparations in the wilderness were made, the way provided. Now, I think that's the right way to read it. And when we read that, we see the majesty of King Jesus, who truly came to comfort us. Loved ones, receive that comfort today. There will be many things vying for your attention and dragging you down, making you not want to take the next step. Over every single one of those stumbling blocks, proclaim this. God says, comfort, be comforted. And he speaks tenderly to you today and tells you, get it back up again. Get back up again. Jesus will be and is more than enough for you. Let's pray. Jesus, you are our perfect king. There is no perfect king besides you, Hezekiah. And all the kings of the people of Israel were all imperfect. You are the only perfect king. Your righteousness is the only righteousness that allows us to stand before our righteous God. And so you have prepared the way in the wilderness for us. And because you did, and eventually you went to the cross for us in this wilderness of this fallen world, and because you rose again, you have prepared the way for us through your body, through the veil that is your body, into the holiest place of all. And so in this desert, in this fallen world, help us to walk the highway of holiness, being comforted by you every step of the way. Help us to receive that strong comfort now as we take the next step in our lives. Some of us may be going to sleep, some of us starting the day. In any case, let us not move from here unless we go with you. Jesus, in your beautiful name we pray. Amen.
there is a candle in every soul, some brightly burning, some dark and cold. There is a spirit who brings a fire, ignites a candle, and makes his home. Carry your candle, run to the darkness, seek out the helpless, confused and torn. Hold out your candle for all to see it. Take your candle, go light your world. Take your candle, go light your world. Frustrated brother, see how he's tried to light his own candle some other way. See now your sister, she's been robbed and lied to, still holds a candle, but without a flame. So carry your candle, run to the darkness, seek out the lonely, the tired and worn. Hold out your candle for all to see it. Take your candle, go light your world. Take your candle, go light your world. We are a family whose hearts are blazing, so let's raise our candles, light up the sky, praying to our Father in the name of Jesus. Make us a beacon in the darkest times. So carry your candle, run to the darkness, seek the hopeless, deceived and poor. Hold out your candle for all to see, yeah. Take your candle, go light your world. Take your candle, go light your world. Hold out your candle for all to see, yeah. Take your candle, go light your world. Take your candle, go light your world.